Bonjour Keltaut.
Ah bonjour.
Vous parlez français?
Un petit peu.
Ok, on va essayer de parler français.
I prefer English if possible.
Ok.
Nuit du lundi 5 au mardi 6 juin 1944, nuit historique. Les Anglo-Américains débarquent sur le sol de Normandie. Dans la nuit, des milliers de tonnes d'acier s'abattent sur les navires où pilonnent les défenses allemandes. Des unités légères prennent pied sur le rivage. Et voici l'aube, au large, l'impressionnante flotte anglo-américaine.
When I was 20 years old, I was training to come to Normandy for the D-Day. We knew very well what was happening because, of course, as young people, we were very interested in listening to the news, listening to speeches by Churchill. We knew about President de Gaulle, or General as he was then. So we knew from them that Europe was suffering from the Nazis. When we arrived in Normandy, we were very much like a family because the tank on which I rode had 5 people on it, and you lived in the tank. You had your food in the tank, and at night you dug a trench underneath the tank and you slept in the trench, 5 of you together in the trench, like children together there, because of the enemy air attacks, because the Luftwaffe could come over and bomb you in the night. But my tank was the first tank which went into the city of Caen. And when we arrived there, we found that the ruins of Caen were so terrible.
Caen et sa banlieue sous les bombes anglo-américaines. La terre de France est redevenue un champ de bataille, et quel champ de bataille!
And so, on the 18th of July, the British tried to come from Caen to Bourg-Bousse. They sent 800 of our tanks from the area of Colombelle through Demouville, Courbeville, towards Cagny and Solier, and all the way, because they were on the level ground, the Germans could see, and the Germans had bigger guns than we had. So the Germans could sit there and just shoot, 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 shoot. So what do we do? This is a problem. Because now they send my regiment and they say, you go up the hill. The headquarters was in the manor. Because you go to Saint-Aignan-Cramenil and you are up at the top and you see everything. The general of the Canadian Army, he has an idea, and he says, we will not go in the daytime when they can see us. We will go at night. And so this is what we called our night march. So we have to drive in the dark across that, because in Cormel we are down low, we are hidden. The Germans cannot see us. We are invisible. We are driving along. And so we are 200 vehicles. We are 60 tanks. We are then a battalion of infantry in other vehicles. So we go from 11 o'clock at night, and at 3 o'clock next morning, we are just looking towards Saint-Aignan, and as the light comes, as the dawn, the sun comes, we can see Saint-Aignan at 500 meters in front of us. So that was the night march. So at 8 o'clock in the morning, Saint-Aignan at that point is a fortress that we have to attack. But because we are so many, we are able to go in very quickly and the Germans see that we are too many, so they go. We arrive safely, so for us, we make a circle all the way around Saint-Aignan, a circle of tanks and infantry, waiting for the enemy to attack us. So we wait 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and I go into that farm, and my tank is now the first tank in the British Army nearest to Berlin and Paris. For 4 hours, nothing happens. And we say, well, why do we not go farther? Why do we not go on the road to Falaise? So this is why we are waiting for the Americans to bomb across in front of us, and then the Polish people will come up. But it doesn't happen yet, because the Germans are now going to counterattack. The Germans at this time have 4 of these massive Tiger tanks which are available, and the German general says Saint-Aignan-Cramenil is the important place. You must go back and you must capture Saint-Aignan-Cramenil. That is your orders. You must go or die. And he sends his 4 great Tiger tanks down from the area of Santo. And so this big tank, which is called a Firefly tank, which is like the Sherman, but it has a bigger gun, with Joe Eakins as the gunner, this tank goes into the woods and sees the Tigers coming down and begins to fire. Bang, bang, bang. All 4 of them are in flames. And so that part of the attack has absolutely failed there, and make another counterattack. So we also have another counterattack of about 20 German tanks and 300 or 400 German infantry. And they also try to come to Saint-Aignan-Cramenil. So this battle goes on from 12 o'clock through the afternoon. But we are able, we and the Scottish infantry, to stay there. And in the end, the Germans, their tanks are destroyed, their men are died or wounded. Now we can advance to Falaise, we can advance to the River Seine, we can advance to Paris, because we are at the top of the hill. And of course I was very proud now, because at that time we did not realise, we were young soldiers, we were fighting, doing our duty. And it wasn't until many years later that we read in the books that this was a very important day. In 1983, my wife, Jai, and I, on holiday in Normandy, and we come to Saint-Aignan. The first time I have come back to Saint-Aignan, my wife said to me, you must go to that door and say you are an English soldier, otherwise we never come back again to Normandy, because you always talk about the war. And she said, you must not speak again ever about the war if you do not go and say, j'étais soldat anglais pendant la guerre. And so I go to a lady who is cleaning her window, and she said, oh, you must go and speak to the deputy mayor who lives just there, Monsieur Boulanger. And so I go and knock on the door, and, oh, ami, ami! And he is so happy and says, why have you not come back all these years? We are here all this time and you never come to see us. And so in 1984, Monsieur Delonte, the mayor of the time, had given us an invitation and said, come and bring all your friends. Bring them all. They must all come. And so 1984, we arrived, 60 veterans. I had written a book about the Battle of Saint-Aignan, a book simply called Tank, Char d'Assaut. I've now written about 20 books altogether. About half of them were about the war, and the others, again, about the problems of aging people throughout the world. So I write either about the war or about problems of aging people like me, because I am now an aging person, so I write now about myself.